Good morning, Reformation Baptist Church. Go ahead and find your seat. We're going to begin worshiping this morning. I want to invite you to find your worship guide, if you would like, which is on one end of each row or the other. So much joy in the air, and it's tremendous to see several families back with us this morning. What a joy it is to come together to worship the Lord on the Lord's Day, a day of worship, day of rest, day of celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This morning, we're going to be called to worship through God's Word. We're going to sing our hymn of the month. We're going to read the Word. We're going to pray the Word. We're going to sing the Word. We're going to hear the Word preached. And then, after quite a long time, we're going to have an opportunity this morning as a church to see the Word. And by see the Word, what we mean is to partake of the ordinance of the Lord's Supper together, to be renewed and nourished in our faith, to see the gospel and living action, the implications of it. And so we're excited to come together around the Word this morning. Sound of children is a joy. Let's go ahead and begin. You'll notice in your worship guide our call to worship, which we need now more than ever in the midst of the cultural crisis before us. We need to worship. We need Christ. We need the local church. And so we come to Psalm 65, verses 1 through 3. Praise is due to you, O God, in Zion, and to you shall vows be performed. Anybody's car? I was wondering for a minute if it was mine, but I don't think it is. Oh, it is my car. I'm blaming that on one of my kids. I just don't know which one. Well, nothing like that to call you to worship. So let's look back at Psalm 65. Praise is due to you, O God, in Zion, and to you shall vows be performed. O you who hear prayer, to you shall all flesh come. When iniquities prevail against me, you atone for our transgressions. What brings us together this morning is the confession of our faith. And all month, we're going to be confessing together the Lord's Prayer. Because for many years, Reformed churches have stood on the pillar of the Apostles' Creed, which we learned last month. The Lord's Prayer, which we're focusing on confessing and learning and memorizing this month. And then the Ten Commandments, which we'll look at and memorize next month. These are the pillars of our faith. And they're helpful guides for us to use in prayer. So you'll notice the Lord's Prayer in the ESV, in your worship guide or in your Bibles. Let's lift up our voices, all of us aloud together, and recite this. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The early Baptist Catechism explains the Lord's Prayer. In question 108, the question is asked, what do we pray for in the first petition? Answer, in the first petition, which is, hallowed be your name, we pray that God would enable us and others to glorify Him and all that whereby He makes Himself known, and that He would dispose all things for His own glory. Question 109 asks, what do we pray for in the second petition? The answer, in the second petition, which is, Thy kingdom come, we pray that Satan's kingdom may be destroyed, and that the kingdom of grace may be advanced, ourselves and others brought into it and kept in it, and that the kingdom of glory may be hastened. And finally, question 110 of the early Baptist Catechism asks, what do we pray for in the third petition? answer in the third petition, which is, thy will be done on earth as it is in what? In heaven. We pray that God, by His grace, would make us able and willing to know, obey, and submit to His will in all things as the angels do in heaven. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank You in the midst of the uncertainties in this world that we know where to run. And we run to You. We thank You that we can trust You and that You care for us and that You don't stand distant from us. And because of Christ, You're not angry with us. Lord, we thank You that You're good. Hallowed be Your name. We lift up Your name as it already is. And this morning, we don't want to exalt the preacher or the singer or anyone in the church. Lord, we are here to exalt the name of Jesus. Your kingdom come and Your will be done. Father, we pray in the midst of riots in the street. We pray in the midst of conversations over racism and everything else. We pray that the rule of God would be displayed on the streets, in our hearts, in our homes, in our churches. Oh God, we pray that it would be displayed as it is already in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and help us to be content with Your provision. And forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. Lord, please forgive us. We are a needy people with sinful, bloodstained hands in need of Your forgiveness. Cleanse our guilty consciences and dissolve our shame before Christ. And help us to be not only a forgiven people, but a forgiving people. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. In the midst of Satan's schemes and wiles, we pray that You would help us, Lord, to walk in the truth and to sing Your truth and the greatness and the glory of the name above all names, the name of Jesus Christ this morning. What a joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing our hymn of the month, How Great Thou Art, together as Miriam comes to lead.
Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder Standing for the reading of the covenant. If you would read the lighter statements, and I'll read the, y'all read the bolder statements, and I'll read the lighter statements. We, the members of Reformation Baptist Church, hereby affirm this covenant with one another by God's grace for our good and for God's glory. Having been brought, as we believe, by the Spirit of God and divine grace to repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Lord, Savior, and supreme treasurer of our lives, and upon the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we do, in the presence of God and this assembly, solemnly and joyfully covenant with one another as one body in Christ to glorify God by worshiping together and making disciples. Together we resolve to love Christ above all, to seek God's kingdom through regular devotion and prayer, and actively fight against our sin. Together, we resolve to come together. By the Holy Spirit, we will strive for the unity of this church in knowledge, holiness, love, and peace, and to promote its fruitfulness in the true preaching of the gospel and right use of its ordinances. We will partake of the Lord's Supper as we remember the past work of Christ on the cross, celebrate the present work of Christ at the Father's right hand, and anticipate the future work of Christ in his return for the full redemption of his bride. Together, we resolve to watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember one another in prayer, participate in one another's joys, and bear one another's burdens. We will cultivate Christian compassion and be slow to take offense, always being ready for reconciliation. We will humbly and graciously confront and receive correction from one another through biblical church discipline and restoration. We will edify one another with our speech and encourage one another in our example. Together, we will resolve to pray for and submit to the leadership which has been entrusted by God to the shepherd this body by exemplifying godliness and equipping the saints for the work of the ministry. Together, we resolve to seek the salvation of our family and neighbors. We will maintain family worship and train our children and those under our care according to the Christian faith. Together, we resolve to walk wisely in the world, to be faithful in our engagements, and Christ exalting in our lifestyles, to avoid all gossiping and abstain from all practices which will be unwarranted harm to the body of one's faith. We will contribute cheerfully and sacrificially to the support of the church, aid of those in need, and spread of the gospel through all nations. If we move from this place, we will, if possible, unite with one another biblical church of like faith and practice, where we can carry out the Spirit of the covenant and the truths of the Word of God. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. You may be seated, and I'll give you just a few minutes to lift up our own prayers and concerns to the Lord. Lord Jesus, as we come before you this morning, we bow in humility. And Father, we ask you to examine our hearts this morning. Show us anything that's not pleasing to you. Father, reveal any secret pride, any unconfessed sin, any unforgiveness that may be hindering our relationship with you. Father, we know that you love us with regenerated hearts and knowing that the price you paid for us covered us for all time. As we take your bread this morning, Father, representing your life that has been broken for us, we remember and celebrate your faithfulness to us. We can't begin to understand the suffering you endured for us. But thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love and unmerited favor and abundant lives now and our eternal lives forever. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath the flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains.
You would please turn in your Bibles and remain standing to 1 Kings chapter 8. We're going to be reading verses 22 through 30, and then also in the same chapter, verses 54 to 61. That's about it. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands toward heaven and said, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and showing steadfast love to your servants who walk before you with all their heart. You have kept with your servant David, my father, what you declared to him. You spoke with your mouth and with your hand have fulfilled it this day. Now therefore, O Lord, God of Israel, keep for your servant David, my father, what you have promised him, saying, you shall not lack a man to sit before me on the throne of Israel. If only your sons pay close attention to their way, to walk before me as you have walked before me. Now therefore, O God of Israel, let your word be confirmed, which you have spoken to your servant David, my father. But will God indeed dwell on the earth? Behold, heaven in the highest heaven cannot contain you. How much less this house that I have built? Yet have regard to the prayer of your servant, to his plea. O Lord my God, listening to the cry and to the prayer that your servant prays before you this day, that your eyes may be open night and day toward this house, the place of which you have said, my name shall be there, that you may listen to the prayer that your servant offers toward this place. And listen to the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place, and listen in heaven, your dwelling place, and when you hear, forgive. Verse 54. Now as Solomon finished offering all this prayer and plea to the Lord, he arose from before the altar of the Lord, where he had knelt with hands outstretched toward heaven. And he stood and blessed all the assembly of Israel with a loud voice, saying, blessed be the Lord who has given rest to his people Israel, according to all that he promised. Not one word has failed of all his good promise, which he spoke by Moses, his servant. The Lord our God be with us, as he was with our fathers. May he not leave us or forsake us, that he may incline our hearts to him, to walk in all his ways, and to keep his commandments, his statutes, and his rules, which he commanded our fathers. Let these words of mine, with which I have pleaded before the Lord, be near to the Lord our God day and night, and may he maintain the cause of his servant and the cause of his people Israel, as each day requires, that all the people of the earth may know that the Lord is God, there is no other. Let your heart therefore be wholly true to the Lord our God, walking in his statutes and keeping his commandments as at this day. You may be seated. That ends the reading of God's good, holy, and inspired word.
What a tremendous prayer that we read there in 1 Kings 8. Oh Lord, there is no God like you. There is no other God. Oh Lord, you have promised. Oh Lord, you have spoken. Well, he has spoken through his word, and we come together around God's word to feast on God's word and then to feast at God's table this morning. So as we move from an example of an Old Testament prayer at a very decisive time in the lives of God's people, I want to invite you to turn back over to Colossians chapter 4. Colossians chapter 4, the title of my sermon this morning is A Healthy Church is a Praying Church. A healthy church is a praying church. And we need this woven into the foundation and fabric of who we are as a church. It is utmost essential and vital, which is why we don't just rush through this as if it weren't. Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 through 4 is the passage before us this morning. That's where we'll be as we continue to make our way through Colossians. But as we come to chapter 4, we turn a corner. In order to put this into perspective, I want to back up just a little bit because we've taken so much time to plow through this with a microscope. At times, it's helpful to back up from more of a telescope and put the whole thing in perspective. If you remember, Paul began in chapter 1 of Colossians, or what we know of as chapter 1. This is simply a letter written to a local church. Paul began by thanking God for their faith, their love, and the hope that they had, referring to this local church in Colossae. He said that the gospel had produced undeniable fruit in their lives, and not only in their lives, what it had done in Colossae was a sort of microcosm for what the gospel has been doing and is still doing around the world, calling men and women, boys and girls, to faith and repentance in Jesus Christ. And this fruit is taking over the planet, Paul says. And he reminds them that they have learned the gospel, this word, from Epaphras, who is one of them, a fellow and beloved servant. One who we'll see in chapter 4, verse 10 through 12, is laboring, giving himself and wrestling in prayer for their souls and their maturity. And then Paul prays that they would be filled with the truth, and not only just to have a head full of knowledge, but that they would be filled with the truth so that they could then walk in accordance with the truth. And then he says that he prays that they would be filled with strength, with endurance, with patience, all characteristics that we need afresh in our day, with patience and with joy. And then in chapter 1, Paul, starting in verse 15, highlights the lordship of Christ over all creation, including which is the church. He is Lord over his people. And then he continues to show how the gospel has provided for their reconciliation with God. And he has done that through the death of his son, Jesus Christ. And then Paul doesn't just stop there. He expresses how he's been laboring, fully giving himself for their maturity in Christ, that they would grow up in the knowledge of the same thing that saved them. And what we know of is chapter 2, then Paul then began to transition, and he passionately pleads and lays out his love, exemplifying his labor for this church, that they would grow up in Christ. He prays that they would be knit together in love, which is my prayer for this church. He prays that they would be rooted deeply in the knowledge of Christ, which is what we need today with so many competing ideologies of what the truth is. And then he prays that they would be discerning in falsehood, being able to tell the truth from error. And he spends the rest of chapter 2 unpacking the importance of spiritual discernment in the church. And if there were ever a day when spiritual discernment in the church is lacking, that would be our day. And he calls them again to the truth, to hold fast to the truth. And he begins to highlight over and over, not only that Christ is sovereign, sovereign over every particle of this universe, but Christ is also sufficient. He is enough for everything that we need for life and for salvation, for holiness and godliness. There is nothing missing out there that we don't have, that we already have in Christ. So this drumbeat over and over through Colossians that Christ is sovereign and Christ is sufficient. And then we come to what we know of as chapter 3, where we see not only the lordship of Christ over all creation and over the church, but now Paul gets personal and Paul gets specific. We see the lordship of Christ over the heart and over the home. The call, therefore, because he is the sovereign Lord and he is sufficient, we're to put to death all the vices of sin within us, and we're to daily put on the virtues of Christ and to walk in the ways of Christ. Look with me in verse 16 of chapter 3. He says that we're to see that the word of Christ dwells in us richly, and that we're to sing the praises of God thankfully. And then he moves from the heart, as you know, because we spent about 2 months there, he moves to the home. And all of the individuals in the home who demonstrate the lordship of Christ through their responsibilities to one another in the home. But when we come to chapter 4 in Colossians, we turn the final corner in this letter. We come to final instructions that begin with a call to prayer. I want you to go back to Colossians 1, and I want you to, therefore, before we really unpack this as we put it in perspective, I want you to see Colossians 1, 13 through 14. Paul begins by praying for the church. And one of my goals through this sermon is to call us to be a people of prayer, a church of prayer, and to pray the Word, to be fueled by the Word of God in our prayers, to pray the priorities of Scripture. What did Paul pray? What were his themes for this local church in Colossians 1? Actually, it's 3 to verse 14. He begins, as we've already said, by thanking God in verse 3, 4, and 5 for their faith, for their love, and for their hope in the truth. He's thankful for these people. Friends, I say this with all sincerity in my heart. I am thankful for this church. The powers of hell have tried to unravel this church in more ways than one over the last 4 months. The demons of darkness have come against this church, and if what we experienced back in January weren't enough, then we can't meet for 2+ months. And now it's something else, and it always will be. But this morning, we celebrate the grace of Christ. We're coming to the Lord's table together. Amen. God has sustained His grace in this church, and He will continue to do that. I am thankful for what God's doing in this church. Are you? Amen. I look around and see evidences of God's grace everywhere, and it's so sincere, it's genuine. It's not without sin and failure, but God is doing something. And Paul saw it in the Colossians. And so he thanks God for them, and then he asks God to fill them with knowledge and wisdom, the same thing that we need, so that they would walk in accordance with the truth, so that they would walk worthy of the Lord who purchased them. He prays that they would be strengthened in faith. And he prays for their endurance and patience with joy. He prays and he gives thanks to God for them, and he recalls the gospel. He rehearses the gospel, what we'll do this morning at the Lord's Prayer, the Lord's table. And he reminds them that God has delivered them from their guilt, from their shame, from their sin through the death and resurrection of Christ. Are these the themes in our prayers as a church? Are these the themes in your prayers individually and in your families? Paul prays for the church. But I want you to see the second half of this framing of the whole letter by flipping back over to where we started in Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 through 4. Paul not only prays for them, now Paul asks them to pray for him. To pray for him. One modern pastor summarized that prayer is the strength of the believer's fellowship with the Lord and the source of His great power against Satan and his angels. We don't realize the spiritual warfare that we're caught up in. A prayer is not just a cute, self-centered sentiment. Friends, prayer is dangerous. And dangerous things happen when people pray. When people pray, other people die at times in Scripture. When people pray in Scripture, at other times, people are made alive. It's nothing to play with. One pastor said, through prayer, believers confess their sin, which we've done this morning. They offer praise to God. They call on their sympathetic high priest, and they intercede for each other. He says prayer from a pure heart is to be directed to God, consistent with the mind and will of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Christ and for the glory of the Father. This is where our strength is. This is what you need coming in here, weary and burdened from the week, your mind already racing to other things. We need to be given to prayer. In Colossians 4, 2 through 4, we see vital instruction and we also see practical application. Number one, to frame our time together, we will see that a healthy church is relentlessly resolved to be a people of prayer. And then number two, we will see that a healthy church is given to persistent prayer for the declaration of salvation. Let's begin with number one, a healthy church is relentlessly resolved to be a people of prayer. I want you to note the themes in these three verses. A healthy church in Colossians 4, 2 through 4, is given to prayer that's faithful. We're to be given to prayer that's watchful. We're to be given to prayer that's thankful. We're to be given to prayer that's purposeful. Look with me in verse 2. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. Let's read that together out loud. Continue steadfastly in prayer. being watchful in it with thanksgiving. And we need to go back again to Colossians 3:16, putting this in place. If you remember, he's already dealt with the Word of God, with Scripture, with the Word of Christ. Because what did he say about the Word? Is to dwell in us how? Richly. So the Word of God is to be fundamental, foundational. And so now it's no surprise that Paul comes to prayer. Prayer and the Word. Prayer and the Word. Along with the ordinances that we'll partake of this morning, these are the ordinary means of grace for Christian discipleship. You say, Brandon, how do you intend to build and grow this church? Well, first of all, I don't intend to build this church because Jesus said that he would do that, and I don't intend to be in competition with Jesus. But second of all, he gave us means for the growth of the church, and these are the means: prayer, the Word, and the ordinances. And this is what we trust in. And this is the means that we experience God to grow in Christ's likeness. A preacher was asked one time, which is more important, the Word of God or prayer? The Word of God or prayer? To which he responded, when you're on an airplane, which is more important, the left wing or the right wing? Certainly, we have to begin with the Word, because the Word tells us to pray. It tells us the one to whom we pray, and it tells us how we're required to relate to him. But the Word of God leads us to communion with God, which is why we spend so much time when we're together praying. And the Word tells us how to relate to God and how to please God. So look with me in verse 2. He says, continue steadfastly. Oh, this is dripping with honey. The New King James says, continue earnestly. The New American Standard says, devote yourselves. This is one Greek word, and it literally means to attend constantly to. It means to cling closely to remain constant in, to give continual attention. It means to always be in a ready position. I think we know what it means to cling closely to something. Here lately, many people are clinging closely to their newsfeed, to social media, to hobbies or sports, maybe to a job that you get fulfillment out of, maybe to relationships. Do you know what it means to be in an emotionally needy relationship? They're clingy. And this is the idea. Cling closely. Don't get far from. Always be in a position of constant readiness and never to be caught off guard. Romans 12, verse 12 says, rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, and be constant in what? Prayer. What do we find the early church doing as soon as we meet them? In Acts chapter 2, verse 42, we read that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Is that what we're devoted to as a church? Is that what you're devoted to? In Acts chapter 6, verse 4, we get a snapshot so that we can see the DNA of a healthy church just again a few chapters in, where we read, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and what? The Word. In other words, what God has joined together, even in this, don't let man separate. Alexander McLaurin, an early preacher, said, there may be unbroken communion, a constant consciousness of God's presence and our contact with Him, thrilling through our souls and freshening them. Friends, is that what you need this morning? A constant consciousness of God's presence. We need this morning to be renewed with the conscious consciousness that God is with His people. And He's not deserted us. He's not let us alone. He has promised and He will remain faithful. And we need to give ourselves in constant, continual prayer. What I mean by that is living our entire lives in the fear of God, before the face of God, doing everything we do in the conscious presence of God. But at the same time, we also need times of concentrated prayer, where we set time aside and we wrestle with the Lord in prayer. We give ourselves in prayer for an extended period of time. In Luke chapter 18, Jesus taught his disciples to pray by giving them a parable whereby he taught them to continually, persistently pray and don't lose heart. In 1 Thessalonians 5, 6, he says, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances." Do you see again the marriage between gratitude and prayer? Gratitude and prayer. Hold on to that. He says, "For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." Paul uses this general word for prayer 10 times in the New Testament. This is the Christian's breath. This is the air we breathe, communion with God. And what this includes is several different types of prayer. This is a general word that would include times of adoration. So, church family, we should be given to just adoring the Lord, praising God for the greatness of His might. Adoration. This includes times of confession, of teaching our sin, teaching that Christ forgives our sin and going to Him in prayer for that. We have a time of confession every Sunday morning. And we don't do that because we think that there's something magical and Roman Catholic in that time so that we can go live like hell all week long, because then we're going to come and participate in the prayer of confession on Sunday and then all is going to be good. The reason why we do that is to imprint a model in our lives so that it becomes a consistent pattern that we are continually going to the Lord and confessing our sins and finding the assurance of His pardoning grace. So adoration and confession and thanksgiving should be a part of our prayers. Let me ask you a question. Do you spend time just thanking the Lord? Just grateful to God for what He's already given you before you ask Him for anything else? I think one of our major problems in the church today, then the solution to the problem, is that we need to be a thankful people. We need to be a grateful people. And then supplication, interceding for the needs of others. So I want you to look in Colossians 2, rather 4, 2 through 4. He calls us to personal prayer, which is where it begins. And then, beginning in verse 5, he's going to call us to public action. And he's going to marry these two together, continual prayer and unwearied action. Men and women should be people of persistent prayer. We should be constantly on the alert. We should be alive to the will of God. We should be aware of the needs of this world. We should be ready to give an account for the stewardship that God has given us. And he says in Colossians 4, look in your Bibles, to do so watchful. We're to be wide awake. This is a heightened sense of alertness. If you have the New King James Version, it says vigilant. It means wake up. We don't need to be weary in prayer. We need to be watchful by giving ourselves to prayer. Have you ever noticed how easy it is for our spiritual senses to become dull after a period of time? It's just to fall into the same old, same old. And we can't afford to let that happen. Not now. The stakes are too high. You see, the Greek word used here is the concept of some Christian who is so in tune to God and the world around him that he's like the soldier who is mentally alert, standing on his post, so focused on his target to the point that he can hear the slightest snap of the smallest twig. He's in tune. He's not cold in calling upon God. The Gospels use this, Jesus speaks of this oftentimes of literal sleeping. In Mark 14, verse 37, we read, "And he came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, 'Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch, there it is, and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is what? Weak.'" 1 Peter 4:7, the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, here's God's call to the church, both then and now. Be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober-minded. Be, here it is, are you ready? Be watchful. Wake up, church. Your adversary, the devil, prowls like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. This is always cute, and it's always a nice little warning until you see the devil actually on the prowl, attacking a marriage that is on its last limb, seeking to destroy a home, seeking to destroy a heart with depression or suicide or whatever else it is, seeking to destroy a church. And the Bible says to be watchful. To a literal church in Revelation chapter 3, Jesus calls the church to wake up and strengthen what remains before it dies, and to do so through repentance. We're in a season where there needs to be repentance on the church's part. Repentance before God to be watchful in prayer, to be biblically minded. Luke chapter 12, verse 37 says, blessed are those servants whom the master finds awake when he comes. Paul says, be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong, engaging in serious spiritual warfare through prayer, through prayer. William Hendrickson is an excellent commentator, and if you want some help studying the Bible, I would send you to his commentaries. And I love what he says about being watchful. He explains what I believe to be true, that when Paul uses this word in Colossians 4, I don't think he's so much talking about literal don't go to sleep. I think that he's referring to being alive to the things around us, central to which is God. First of all, being alive and aware to the needs that we have in our families, in our church, in our community, in our world. Being aware and alert. He means being aware to the dangers that threaten the church and standing guard, standing post to false ideologies, false teachings that attempt to slip themselves in through the music of the church, through the books of the church, through the media that comes into the heads of church members. To be alive to the blessings that have been received already and promised once more. To be alive to the will of God. This is what it means to be watchful. And then continue in Colossians. Another important element of being a praying church. This is what we need in our church more and more. He says, with thanksgiving, which has been called the crown of all prayer. Beginning with the opening verses in Colossians, seven times Paul laces the entire letter with thankfulness. You see it in nearly every chapter. It frames this letter from the very beginning to the very end. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 15, again, he refers to the peace of Christ ruling in your heart. How can you, Christian, how can you be so confident and so settled and so stable when you read the headlines going on around us and when you even look at the things going on within us? Because the Christian sees that the peace of Christ rules his heart. And we can do that today. And he says in Colossians 3, not only to let the peace of Christ rule in your heart, but be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And in case you didn't get it the first two times, again in Colossians 3, 17, do everything you do in the name of the Lord Jesus, you guessed it, giving what? Thanks to God. Every church kind of has the tendency to be known for one thing or the other. That's the theology church. If you want to get a lot of doctrine crammed down your throat, you go there. This is the social action church. They're always doing things in the community. And this is that church, and this is that church. I would be perfectly satisfied if the word on the street could be in our community, what about Reformation? That's a thankful church. Because that's a thankful people. Because they realize who they were. And they realize what they were. And now they know what God's made them. That's a thankful people. Calvin says that Paul adds thanksgiving so that as new requests are made, the former requests that have already been received will be remembered. He says we're not to murmur at God's provision, but whatever God provides, we're to receive it contently. Friends, let's stop just for a minute, can we? Can we just do a bit of inventory? Can I force this to the front of your mind? Is your life and mine as laced with thanksgiving as this whole letter is? Is it a common theme on our lips and in our hearts? Before we even ask for anything else, we're just so thankful for what God's already given us. Every good thing that we have is from God. Why does he say with thankfulness? Well, James chapter 4 says that when we ask of God, we're not to ask so that we can get something and spend it on our own sinful desires or our own vainglory, but we're to ask in prayer in thankfulness. 2 Corinthians 1, Paul says that he's in over his head. He has the sentence of death over his life, and he asks with prayer so that God would deliver, and then the people could be thankful for what God's provided. I don't know about you, friends, but I want to see some things happen around here that only God could do. I want to see God do some things in our midst that people would look up and say, that's clearly in line with the Word, and only God could do that. And I think that we already have. So they're to be watchful with thanksgiving, or in thanksgiving, or by thanksgiving. Scholars debate on exactly how those words fit together, but nonetheless, I want to back up again and think about this. Look at me, where is Paul? Is Paul in a palace? Is Paul living it up? And you think, boy, easy for you to say. Easy for you Americans to say that we ought to be thankful because you have everything. Where is Paul as he's writing these words? He's chained to a Roman guard under house arrest, his whole life under the control of the Roman tribunal. And Paul is saying that his gratitude is not contingent on positive circumstances. There's a word right there, isn't it? This just hit home immediately for me. Our gratitude is not contingent on positive circumstances. How often we can slip into this kind of thinking. Have you ever done it? If only my circumstances could change, then I could have peace and be thankful. Said Adam and Eve in the perfect paradise before all hell broke loose. Listen, I'll tell you, like I shared with one couple going through a very difficult time this week, we spent much time together. Friends, if you don't learn whatever circumstances you're in, to find the peace that's in Christ, you will never have it. You'll never have it. You have to see it where you are now. In all things. And here's the beauty of Christian theology. We actually have the belief system, the truth, the theology that provides a foundation for why we can be thankful no matter what. Because we truly know and we truly believe that God really does order all things for His glory and our good, and His divine providence is always directing everything. So the remembrance of these former mercies, these prayer requests that God's already answered, would then shoot them in spontaneous praise and worship of God. But it would also, just like them, so us, when we begin to see God answer one prayer, we begin to get confident in presenting more. Because we see that God is listening. God, in some way, according to His will, He's moving, He's acting. He's at work in the world. Philippians 4, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by, here it is, prayer and supplication with what? Thanksgiving. Over and over, let your requests be made known to God. 1 Thessalonians, rejoice always. Prayer and thanksgiving. I do want you to see one other passage. If you would, flip in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18 through 20 is a sort of commentary on the passage before us in Colossians chapter 4, verse 2 through 4. It's a parallel where Paul says a similar thing to a closely related church, unpacking it just a bit more, giving us more information and more truth. Ephesians 6, 18, which is set in the context of spiritual warfare, which I believe that we find ourselves in today, which is a war over ideas. That's the war that we're in right now. And as you're seeing, when words lose their meaning, people lose their lives, and they are today. And in that context of spiritual warfare, in Ephesians 6, 18, he says, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance. Wake up, making supplication for all the saints. And also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Paul goes on, and now he gives us what we'll call number two, and that's this. A healthy church is given to persistent prayer for the declaration of salvation. Now he tells us what specifically should we be praying for. And as we continue to transition on there, let me ask you one more question, just to kind of give a bit of gauge in where our hearts are together. If I were to say this Wednesday night, we have a glorious treat, a wonderful time planned together. We're going to spend a solid hour in just prayer. It's important to take prayer requests. I think that builds community. It gives us awareness of one another. It's important to preach. But if I were to say, and I'm not, but if I were, that this Wednesday we're going to give the whole night just to simply closing our eyes, lifting our voices, and praying, would you be honest before God? Please be honest. Would you be more likely to come or less likely to come? I want you to see specifically, as I kind of leave that question with you, what Paul asked them to pray for in Colossians chapter 4, verse 3. Colossians chapter 4, verse 3. I make no apology for chasing you around the Bible. That's why we're here. Please come up to me afterwards and say, so many scriptures. That's the point, and you're fixing to see why. At the same time, pray also for us. Paul's prayed for them, now they're to pray for Paul. What do we pray? You ever thought that? What do we pray for? What do we pray for? That God may open to us a door for the Word. Word and prayer. To declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear which is how I ought to speak. This is Paul's mission. This is the pattern in the book of Acts, and it's what I hope to see the pattern at Reformation Baptist Church. Listen to what Paul would do. He would proclaim the gospel, he would gather the believers, he would plant a church, and then he would shepherd it to maturity and health. He would proclaim the gospel, he would gather the believers, he would plant a church, and then he would shepherd it to maturity and health. He would proclaim the gospel, he would gather the believers, he would plant a church, and then he would shepherd it to health and maturity. This is the roadmap for where we plan to go, Lord willing, in the next decade, two decades, however long the Lord leads us here and leads us together. Proclaim the gospel, gather the believers, plant a church, which we are, shepherd it to health and maturity, which we're in the process of doing. And then when you begin to make progress in there, what do? You start over, you go find somewhere where the gospel's not being proclaimed, and you proclaim it. Then you gather the believers that are the fruit of conversion. Are you with me? You then plant a church among those believers, and then you shepherd it to health and maturity. And you say, what's next? Do you really want me to say it again? So people are, asking rightfully, so what should we expect? I'm just telling you, that's my heart. I think that's the Bible's heart. This is what we want to do. We want to be a church that reproduces. We want to be a church that plants other churches. That's going to take some time. We can't do that tomorrow, if you remember the context that we're currently in right now. But it's the goal. It's the goal. So he says, at the same time. In other words, as you pray, pray for me. You know who the neediest soul on the planet that needs prayer the most is? You are. I'm kind of uncomfortable praying for myself. I don't know why. You need it more than anybody else around you. I'll pray for other people, but I just don't like asking people to pray for me. You're telling me that the Apostle Paul had the nerve and the neediness to ask other Christians to pray for him, and you don't think you need people to pray for you? If you don't want anyone praying for you, can you just please, and I'm asking honestly, not sarcastically, will you commit to one thing for me? Will you pray for me? There's no one more needy in this church in need of prayer than me, than my wife, than our children. We need prayer. We have clay, flesh, feet, just like you do. We have Satan's target on our back as much or more than you do. We make mistakes. We battle sin. We're men and women. Pray for us, Paul says. He had Timothy with him in chapter 1, verse 3. He had their boy Epaphras with him in chapter 1 and chapter 4. Some of you are like, man, are you really going to go through the closing credits in chapter 4? To which I'm thinking, you know what my favorite part of Colossians and all of Paul's letters are? You're going to think I'm crazy, but it's the closing credits. Closing credits. You know why? Because Paul's also asking that they would pray for his co-laborers. What that means is he wasn't a lone ranger. There were other people in the ministry, in the trenches, together with him, and he's saying, pray for us. Friends, we need to pray for one another, specifically. How many of you have a church directory, and you spend at least a couple days a week praying through your church directory? This is a test. Will you please raise your hand? Will you please commit to doing that? Just a few moments a day. Let's pray for each other. And as you do, you're going to think, I don't know how to pray for them. There's an ulterior motive here. Now you're going to have to get to know them so you know how to pray for them. And in the meantime, you can just pray for them what the Bible prays for them. He says that God may open to us a door. He gives them the content. A door being an opening. It's something through which something else would go through. It's an opportunity that Paul's praying for. Now, is Paul praying that he'd be released from prison so that he could publish the gospel more broadly? Maybe. Is Paul praying that there would be some specific opportunity, something on his mind? Maybe. Is Paul saddling up because he knows before long, at some point, he's going to stand before the Roman tribunal, the leader of the known world, and he's going to give an account? We don't know exactly what's going on. But we do know that he prays this, or he asks prayer for this over and over. And isn't it interesting to notice that he is chained under guard, having no clue what his future holds for sure? Question, does he pray that God would keep him safe? Does he pray for his own personal health? None of those things would be bad to ask for prayer in. What does Paul ask for prayer in? For his gospel witness. He doesn't pray, God, keep me safe without harm. He prays that the gospel would run through his life. 1 Corinthians 16 says, for a wide, here it is again, door for an effective work is open to me, and there are many adversaries. Watch this. Paul says, I'm praying for a door that would open, a greater opportunity to share Christ. And God has opened that door for me because there's adversaries there. Wait a minute, what? there's adversaries there. I thought that meant there wasn't a door and I need to go somewhere else. What if there are adversaries to God and the gospel, therefore that's the door through which I'm to enter? This is right where I need to be. In 2 Corinthians, he says that there's an opportunity open for him to preach, but he didn't take it because Titus wasn't with him. So there are times that he wouldn't, but he wants God to make it clear. In Acts 14, the church is rejoicing because God's opened a door for the gospel to go to the Gentiles, to the non-Jews. And in Revelation chapter 3, verse 8, he says, I have set before you an open door. Was there ever a wider open door in our lifetimes than there is right now? There's a wide open door in the search for truth, the marketplace for truth. We don't know specifically what this is, but we do know that at the end of the book of Acts, for 2 years, he's under house arrest. And he's praying that God would open a door, and in the meantime, he's using the doors that God has already opened. He's being faithful right where God's put him. You say, what is Paul doing while he's in prison? Is he moping? Is he throwing a pity party and inviting himself as the guest of honor? He's writing letters. Not just any letters, but letters that would become the New Testament, by the way. And he's proclaiming Christ to a mob. He's proclaiming Christ to Felix, to Roman officials, to soldiers. Matter of fact, in Philippians, it says that the word of the gospel through Paul's arrest has made its way throughout all of the Roman guard into Caesar's house. My question for us and for the church is, where are the churchmen of our day willing to pray and to commit ourselves to God like this? Friends, many supposed Christians won't even get out of their pajamas to come to an air conditioning building to be treated like kings in a worship service. We won't even deny ourselves the slightest earthly inconvenience and discomfort. I'm telling you, I think this is where we are. If we can't hang with the footmen, Jeremiah 12:5 says, how will we ever run with the horsemen? Where is our deep, desperate drive for the things of God, church? J.C. Ryle put it this way, zeal in religion is a burning desire to please God, to do His will, to advance His glory in the world in every possible way. It's a desire which is not natural to man. Listen to me, church. It is a desire which the Spirit puts in the heart of every believer when he's converted. However, a desire which some believers feel so much more strongly than others that they alone deserve to be called zealous men. This desire, Ryle says, is so strong when it really reigns in a man that impels him to make any sacrifice, to go through any trouble, to deny himself to any amount, to suffer, to work, to labor, to toil, to spend himself and be spent, even to die, if only he may please God and honor Christ. A zealous man in religion is preeminently a man of one thing. It's not enough to say that he's earnest, strong, uncompromising, meticulous, wholehearted, fervent in spirit. He only sees one thing. He only cares for one thing. He only lives for one thing. He is swallowed up in one thing, and that is to please God. Friends, the day that we're in, we don't need any more weak jellyfish men. We don't need any more emotional basket case women. We need strong men and women if we're going to stand in the midst of the headlines that we're watching. Amen. And we need to be rooted in the truth. He says, for the word, which is to declare the mystery of Christ, the mystery that Jews and Gentiles are now one in Christ and that the gospel is going to all places of all peoples. And he says that he's suffering for this. But the message isn't bound, even though the messenger is bound. Even though Paul is in physical chains, he's spiritually free. I want to ask today, before we come to the Lord's table, how many today is it just the opposite? How many people today are in our country and they're physically free, but they're in spiritual chains? Spiritual chains. They can go and do and see and be whatever they want to do, but they're enslaved to fear and anxiety, to depression, fear of man, anger, lust, whatever it is. And then finally, verse 4, he says that I may make it clear. Let me make this clear. It means to be disclosed, to be revealed plainly. Paul is not in prison for preaching an ambiguous gospel. Paul is not in chains for preaching something that's generally true and that most people would agree with on one level or the other. Listen, if you're in a church and you're not, and you're preaching a message that could set well in a Jewish synagogue, a Mormon tabernacle, or a Protestant church, and there wouldn't be moral outrage in at least one or two of those, you're not preaching the gospel. The reason why Paul is in prison is because he is, are you ready for this? He's clear. Paul isn't striving to be charismatic. He's not striving to be winsome. He's not striving to be eloquent. He's not striving to be impressive. Turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Paul is not striving to win friends and influence people. He's not striving to put his best foot forward. Paul's not striving to give some... His concern was for the message. In 1 Corinthians 2:2, Paul says, the only thing I want to know is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling. And my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. And I don't want the faith of this church to ever be tempted to rest in the preacher, even when that's me. But we want our faith to rest not in a personality. Are you ready for this? But in a person. And the person is Christ. But I'm afraid that in our day of entertainment, we have many professing Christians who say that they want the Word of God. Preach on, brother. But what they really want is an entertaining or a charismatic personality under the guise of the Word of God. And what Paul's doing here is he's taking people, and he's being very clear to Jews, and he's saying that there is no hope for the forgiveness of your sins apart from anyone but the person and work of Jesus Christ. And they're outraged. And they put him in prison. And if there are a way that I could describe this, it's as if they were falling from the sky, the Jews, the people before Paul. And the comfort they had is they are grasping with everything that they have on a rope that they think is going to save them. And the only problem is that they don't realize that that rope is not attached to anything at the top, but it is falling as fast to destruction as the person who's holding it. It's illusion. And what Paul does by preaching the gospel is he takes the rope out of their hands so that they can see that they have no way in their self-righteous attempts to keep the law, to please God. They're without hope and spiritually bankrupt to keep the law and the tradition. And then Paul offers them a rope that is attached to something that's stable and secure, and they scorn the rope and they say, we want nothing to do with it. He says, which is how I ought to speak. John Calvin said that Paul desired for himself an undaunted confidence, such as befits the majesty of the gospel. We need undaunted confidence today, church. We need confidence in the truth. We need confidence in the presence of God, not our own arrogance or pride. If we're going to be strong, we need confidence. Acts 23 says, take courage, for as you have testified to the facts about me in Jerusalem, so you must testify also in Rome. And make no mistake about it, the people who imprisoned Paul were religious people. The people that you would never expect. And I don't know where in the years ahead, months ahead, the Lord will put us to testify in places that we may not have thought, but He says, take courage. And He says, wake up. And He says, to be vigilant. And He says, to be steadfast in prayer, and don't let the Lord come back to find us asleep at the wheel. Friends, are you desperate for God? This morning, do you find yourself delighting in God, going hard after God? What's the state of your soul this morning? I want to invite you to acknowledge your dire need for God, to run to His grace. And I want to invite you and us together to continue steadfastly in prayer. Reformation, let's be watchful in it with thanksgiving. And as we do, let's pray also for each other and for others that God would open, even to us, a door for the Word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which even more will be put in prison. And let's make it clear, which is how we ought to speak. The greatest confidence, the greatest compliment that you can give to any preacher is not that the sermon was deep. What did he say? I don't know. It was deep. The greatest confidence that any preacher and any Christian could have is it was clear. It was clear. We knew exactly what he was saying. It was very clear. And the gospel is clear. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for the Word of God, which renews our souls. Lord, would you prepare us this morning to feast at your table, to enjoy your presence, to repent from our sins and to be renewed in Christ. And Lord, would you do a work in our world today like we've never been seen? And would you help us to trust you and be a church that's given to prayer? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We read our church.